Why do we gather here this night? Why do we gather in the dark and silence to mark his death when, sadly, it is not unique and never has been? In his day, the crucified lined the streets, a macabre reminder that power hates challenge of any kind. The story is eerie in its utter transference to situations today and throughout history. The push by the desperate, powerful against the pedestal of high ideals. The predictable unpredictability of the crowds, who at one moment shout their support, yet at the first sign of smoke, assume fire, and just as quickly withdraw and doubt and even bay for blood. Who realize too late that they've been duped, and then stand sadly on the sidelines, wringing their hands, wishing things had been different. Then they go home and live exactly the same way until the next time. And there are the ones more closely involved, the friends and colleagues and hangers-on, who still abandon ship and deny knowledge and even betray. There are the ones in a position to stop the injustice, who choose to turn away and wash their hands of the whole sad, sordid affair. The characters take up their positions, and the play begins again and again and again. Crucifixions happen all the time. The story is harrowing because it is so familiar. So why this execution? Why this man? Why do we gather in the dark and silence to mark his death when sadly it is not unique and never has been? Perhaps that's exactly why. Because it represents the inhumanity we are capable of, even towards the totally innocent and completely pure, the very embodiment of goodness. Perhaps his words, "What you do for the least of these, you do to me," echo tonight especially. Perhaps his words from last night still sit in your mind and heart, "This is my body broken for you." And perhaps the words he has yet to say are our only hope. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." We didn't know then. We do know now. And we must change. So tonight we gather and remember his death. We mourn his loss and we grieve the part we play in it. And we consider the crucifixions we witness today, for they are the real reason for our corporate grief.
Thank you.
Let us join responsively in this evening's call to worship. Let us remember
how the sky went dark.
Let us remember
how his mother was there.
Let us remember
how people mocked him.
Let us remember
how his friends fled.
Let us remember
how in the midst of all that, Jesus still chose love.
Let us worship Holy God.
Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "My soul is deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So, could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again he went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Now the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
Thank you.
Good Friday belongs to confession. For on this day we hold to the light everything that went wrong 2,000 years ago. And as we do, we are reminded of everything that is going wrong in the present day. So we breathe deeply. We bow our heads. We speak the truth out loud about who we long to be, and we trust that God is already reaching out for us as we speak. So knowing that, let us pray together. God of unfathomable mercy, if we were there, we'd like to think that we would have defended you. We'd like to think that we would have stopped the guards and silenced the mockery, protected your body, and defended your name. However, if we're honest with ourselves, we probably would have been at the edge of the crowd, silent and afraid. How often are we silent and afraid? How often do we wait for the stones to cry out for us? Forgive us, please forgive us.
Amen.
Even from his place on the cross, even while being met with cruelty and violence, Jesus overflows with truth and grace. He sees those around him. He speaks connection and belonging into existence. He offers forgiveness. Friends, if this is true from the cross, it is certainly true here. We are surrounded by grace.
We are held in love.
We are forgiven. Over and over again.
That truth never changes. Thanks be to God.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will die by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father? And he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a rebel? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all of this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Yeah.
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A female servant came to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them, saying, "I do not know what you're talking about." When he went out to the porch, another female servant saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus the Nazarene." Again, he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly, you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know the man." At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor said again to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." Then he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified! Let him be crucified!" So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." So he released Barabbas to them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered a whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they placed it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him. They took a reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his clothes on him once again. And then they led him away to crucify him.
As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he could not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" The rebels who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on the stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, "Truly, this man was God's son."
Let us pray. God, who asked for a drink, God, who was killed by the state, God, who offered love and grace even from the cross, we are at a loss for words. What do we do with this day? The air is heavy, our hearts are heavy. The suffering of this world feels particularly close, spilling out all over us. And yet, even in this space, we know you are moving. The only reason this is Good Friday is because we are here telling the story, telling his story still. The only thing good about this story is that he kept on with the loving, even in the face of unspeakable cruelty and injustice, still. There's nothing good about cruelty and injustice, nothing that makes it worthwhile, nothing that makes it okay, nothing that takes away the slicing, edgy hardness, yet it goes on still. We have watched at a distance and wrung our hands an ineffective sympathy. We've been far too ready to mock and judge, and we are so easily swayed. Christ, have mercy. We do not understand the extent of what we do. On this Friday, when the goodness of God was put to an unfair, biased test and won, we struggle on still. Will we stay with him or will we go? Will we deny we ever knew him? Or will we face the time of testing beside him? And when it is our turn to forgive each other, will we be able to say, Father, forgive them, when we know what they've done? Even in this space, we know that this is not the end. Give us the heart to hear this story, and give us the courage to let it change us. Amen.
Christ gave his own life for the life of the world. What is it that you can give to this world and to the work of the church? As Christ's body, we are called to give our lives for others and to stretch out our hands to share the gifts we have received. We can never hope to repay Christ for his gift of grace, but this is a start. We will now receive the evening offering.
Thank you.
Let us join together in our prayer of dedication. We give you thanks and praise, O God, for your saving love poured out for us in Jesus Christ. While they are humble and cannot compare to your generosity for us, we ask that you receive these gifts we offer. Use them to help those who are suffering and to show the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb.
We believe that the crucifixion shows us the worst in humanity. Violence inflicted on the innocent, shame poured out in excess, mockery for the sake of mockery, and abandonment of those we love. We believe that Jesus shows us the best in humanity. Grace where grace is undeserved, humility in the face of power, justice in the face of oppression, love that overcomes. So today, as one voice, we choose the latter. We choose love. We choose grace. We choose one another. We choose to remember.